Hello guys, and welcome back to the segment of the course where we're going to be talking about the types of HVAC systems that we have within the industry. HVAC is broad in general. For every single area of application, you have specialized equipment to be used based on preferences such as economic aspects, client preferences, space requirements, capacity, and an extensive list of other considerations to be taken into account before actually choosing the HVAC system that you want to install. So in this course, we'll be going through the different types of HVAC systems and with the generic perspective, without diving into extensive details, just in order for you to have the complete idea about the different systems that we have. Now, HVAC systems can be classified under two categories. The first one is the decentralized HVAC system, and the second one is the centralized HVAC system. In the following slide, we're going to be highlighting the main differences between centralized and the decentralized HVAC system. Now, the first system we're going to be talking about is the decentralized HVAC system. If you're going through literature or reading through books about HVAC and comparing the difference between the centralized and the decentralized, you most probably end up being confused about the terminology and the definitions. However, the difference is quite basic and simple. Just keep in mind the following statement. A decentralized HVAC system is the HVAC system in which every single zone or space has a designated unit providing the cooling requirements, where you have the basic components of the refrigeration cycle, the compressor, evaporator, condenser, and expansion valve, all of them to an extent present in an interlinked manner, where you have a refrigerant cycling through the circuit in a complete cycle. You have different types of refrigerants, R410, R22, R132A, all of them are responsible of acquiring the heat from your space. So for a decentralized HVAC system, it's the system where you have designated units with all the major components of the refrigeration cycle present in an interlinked manner where you have the refrigerant passing through them. Now, for the centralized, on the other hand, the cooling to all of the spaces, all of the zones that you're dealing with is being provided by a central plant, which is present in a single location. So let's say you have one location, which is responsible to generate the whole cooling requirements, which is then transferred to provide the cooling requirements to the entire space. Now, the first example we're going to use for a decentralized HVAC system is the window HVAC. Now, this is a very basic HVAC system, which is one of the oldest systems that most probably you've seen at one point or another, where you have all of the components of the HVAC refrigeration cycle present in one unit. Now, you have the evaporator, which is the one inside the space. As you can see from the picture, the one present inside the room. You have the condenser, which is the one present outside of the room. And within the box, you have the compressor and you got the expansion valve, along with specific controls. Now, this is one of the examples of a decentralized HVAC system where we have a unitary unit providing the cooling requirements for a specific space. Now, the second example we'll be using for a decentralized HVAC system is the split unit system, the DX unit. Most probably you've seen this within your house or within buildings. At one point in time, the main unit of application was the window. Then we transitioned towards split units, which is more convenient and it's more hygienic and easy to maintain. The split unit system that we're taking a look at here It's called split because of the fact that you have the indoor unit and the outdoor unit quite separated from each other. On the right-hand side, we have the evaporator, which is present inside the zone or the space that you want to cool. And on the left-hand side, we have the condenser, which is placed outdoors, most probably on the side of the building or the house or at the rooftop. The indoor unit, the evaporator, is connected to the outdoor unit, which is the condenser, through a copper piping, which is shown here in the diagram through the blue line, where you have the refrigerant cycling in a closed cycle between the indoors and the outdoors, where as per the refrigeration cycle that we have discussed earlier, the heat load is picked up from the indoors by the refrigerant. It evaporates, then it goes all the way out to the condenser, which is present at the outdoors, and it releases the heat into the environment for the refrigerant to go back into its liquid state, and the cycle repeats itself. So this unit's called a split system, as per its naming, because the outdoor and the indoor unit, they're quite separated from each other. And this is the second example that we have for a decentralized HVAC system. Now, the third example that we have for the decentralized HVAC system is the VRF. As you can see, there is some sort of similarity between the split unit and the VRF, where both of them, they have the indoor unit and the outdoor unit quite separated and connected with the refrigerant piping. However, for the VRF, we have a single outdoor unit connected to multiple indoor units. That's the major difference, along with the fact that every single indoor unit receives a different amount of refrigerant. Now, if you can take a look and see the triangles that we have right on top of every single indoor unit, we have 8 indoor units with 6 triangles. These triangles represent the nodes, the spots where we have the refrigerant split from the main line into branches. So the refrigerant will be flowing from the outdoor units towards 2 main branches, the one at the bottom, then the one at the top, then it further branches out towards the indoor units. Keeping in mind that these indoor units are present at different locations and providing cooling for different zones or spaces. So the main difference between a split unit and a VRF is basically that we have multiple indoor units connected to an outdoor unit, along with the fact that the indoor units receive different amount of refrigerant, which is then collected and passed towards the outdoor unit. Now, the final example of a decentralized HVAC system that we're going to be discussing is the outdoor package system. From the naming package, it means that everything is packaged in one unit, one box. All the components that we have, the compressor, the evaporator, the condenser, and the expansion valve, all of them are collected and present at one space, one place, which is in this picture, the gray, dark gray box. It has all of the components of the refrigeration cycle present, and then the cold air is just simply blown towards the space through a ducting system. Now take a look at the bright aluminum part of the picture. This is mainly the duct, which is connected with the package unit. The package unit blows the cold air through the ducting, which distributes it to the required space or zone. Now, the second type that we have for the HVAC system is the centralized HVAC system. The centralized, like we said earlier, is present in one geographic location where the plant is responsible for generating the whole cooling requirements, which is then transmitted towards your space or zones. Now take a look at the first paragraph. Let's go through the elaborate definition. A centralized HVAC system is a centralized cooling plant which is generating chilled water to be supplied to units. If you recap from the decentralized HVAC system, the fluid which was cycling throughout the refrigeration system, it was a refrigerant which was responsible for taking the heat from your space, correct? However, for a centralized HVAC system, we're having water pass through cold water, chilled water, which is passing through a piping network, which is responsible for taking the heat from your space or zone. So you have a chilled water system where cold water is passing through a piping network, which is going through equipment called FCUs and AHUs, where FCU stands for fan coil unit and AHU stands for air handling unit, which in turn they blow the cold air into the space as the heat is being absorbed by the circulating chilled water. Now, if you're getting confused with the description of the system, do not worry, towards the end of the slides, I've given you a schematic which clearly represents the definition that we have. Just keep in mind for the following time that basically the main difference between a centralized and a decentralized HVAC system is the equipment allocation as per the cooling requirement, in addition to the type of refrigerant that we're using, the type of fluid which is responsible for the cooling within the space. For a decentralized HVAC system, the main fluid responsible for absorbing the heat is the refrigerant. But for a centralized HVAC system, it's the chilled water which is passing through a piping network, who is responsible for absorbing the heat. Now here's a demonstration for the earlier slide. On the top two pictures, they represent a chiller. A chiller basically an equipment, a machine that helps you generate cold water, where the hot water goes into one side and cold water comes in from the other side. Now the mechanism of how a chiller works will be explained in a different course where we address the design of a chilled water system extensively. However, for the time being, just to keep things quite simple, the hot water goes in, the chiller just absorbs the heat using the same concept of the refrigeration cycle, then the cold water comes out and it goes towards the building or the space that you want to cool. Now take a look at the right side where we have an example of the piping network for the chilled water leaving the chiller. Now you have the hot water going in, cold water coming out. Then let's go to the bottom pictures where we have on the left hand side an FCU, which is the fan coil unit, which is mainly a blower and which is a fan circulating air from your space, passing it over the cold coil where you can see, which is the copper coil, where the water from the chiller, the cold water from the chiller goes in, picks up the heat from your space, and the hot water goes out. On the right hand side, we have a different equipment, which is the AHU, which is a bigger representation for air handling requirements. It's called an air handling unit. In the middle of the unit, you can see that we have this similar mechanism where we have the copper pipes where the cold water goes in, hot water goes out. On the right hand side, we have a filter. On the left hand side, we have the fan with the motor, which is responsible for blowing the air over the coil in order to absorb the heat from your space. If you got confused earlier, this is where things get quite clear for you. Now take a look at the schematic. This represents a building where you have different floors. At the top, at the rooftop, you have the chiller, which is responsible for generating the cold water, as you can see from the blue lines. And the chilled water passes through the piping networks towards the units which are present within the space. You have the FCUs, colored red and blue, and the AHUs, the air handling unit, shown by the white boxes. So the cold water goes in, passes through the units present indoors, collects the heat from the space, the hot water goes out and goes back into the chiller. So basically, this is a very straightforward, clear representation for a centralized HVAC system where the plant responsible for generating the cooling requirements is present in one space and then transmits the cooling ability, let's say, a simplistic representation, towards the space or the zone that you need to provide the cooling for. The second example that we have for a centralized HVAC system is the district cooling. Now, it is similar quite in concept to the chilled water system, where we have a centralized plant providing cooling requirements for a specific area through chilled water. However, for district cooling, it operates at a bigger scale, where we have the cooling plant providing the cooling requirement through chilled water for a number of spaces. As you can take a look at the picture here, we have buildings. Now, in the regular case where you have a chiller, the chiller would be responsible to provide the cooling load for one building, let's say. However, for district cooling system, the plant is responsible to provide is responsible for providing the cooling requirements for a number of buildings. How does that work? Simply put, we have the cooling plant, which is responsible for generating the chilled water. Now, further details about the design of the cooling plant will be discussed in other courses that we're going to be providing. However, the concept is kind of the same in terms of the application for chilled water system, where we have the cooling plant providing chilled water, which is passed through different buildings, as you can see in the picture, through a piping network. And every single building, let's say, we have an ETS. This is the new terminology that you're encountering at this point, which is the ETS. The ETS stands for Energy Transfer System, which is basically a heat exchanger that's responsible for exchanging the heat between the fluid, which is water, passing through the piping network, and the space, which is the building in this case. So this is the second example that we have for a centralized HVAC system. Now keep in mind, in the following courses, we'll be addressing specific design requirements and specific procedure for designing, let's say, the ETS, the heat exchangers, the cooling plant, the chilled system. At this point, we're keeping it quite generic, just to keep you to have just simply to have a clear picture about the different systems that we have, rather than just simply complicating things. We're keeping it quite simplistic and straightforward in order to be able to capture the whole variety of systems that we have.